Hello. In previous lectures, airfoils and pressure distributions were discussed, and lift and drag curves have been presented. But how exactly is the lift coefficient calculated from the pressure distribution? Let's consider an infinitely long wing with an airfoil cross-section. We take out a part with a span of 1 meter. The x-coordinate is oriented along the chord line, and the y-coordinate is perpendicular to this, of course. The origin is on the leading edge. An s-coordinate is defined along the contour of the airfoil starting from the origin. The angle theta is defined as the angle between a line normal to the contour at any point and the y-axis. So, as we follow s along the contour of the airfoil, this angle theta constantly changes. Let's assume that the contour is made up of many very small elements ds. There's a pressure p acting on an element ds. Now suppose we would like to know the normal force, so in y direction, on the piece of a wing with span 1 meter. The force on the strip ds with span 1 is pds. That is pressure times area, right? This force is perpendicular to the surface. If we want to know it in y direction, we have to decompose it in that direction. This is pds times cosine theta. So the normal force on the wing per meter span is the integral from the leading edge to the trailing edge of the force on the lower surface, dp p lower times ds times cosine theta, minus the integral over the contour of the force due to the pressure on the suction side. Now let us concentrate a bit on this cosine theta times ds. If we look at the element ds, we see that in fact ds cosine theta is dx. Now we can transform the integral in an integration along the x-axis, so from 0 to c of pl dx minus pu dx. Okay, let's introduce here the normal force coefficient of an airfoil, defined as the normal force n divided by the free stream dynamic pressure, a half rho v squared, times the chord. If we insert this in the equation for the normal force, we get the normal force coefficient is the integral from 0 to 1 of pl over q times dx over c minus pu over q times dx over c. Now watch the next trick. From both integrals, we subtract p infinity divided by q infinity. That is allowed, since nothing changes. But what we have found now is that, with pl minus p infinity divided by q infinity being cp lower and the other being cp upper, the normal force coefficient on an airfoil is the integral of the area between the upper and lower pressure coefficient distributions. This is a nice result. But how do we get to the lift coefficient? Look at the next diagram. By definition, the lift and drag are perpendicular and parallel, respectively, to the free stream velocity vector. However, we can also express the loading on the airfoil into a force perpendicular to the chord line, the normal force n, and the force in chord direction t, the tangential force. And if we would express the lift force into components of n and t, we find L equals n cosine alpha minus t sine alpha. This is then also true for the coefficients. So CL is CN cosine alpha minus CT sine alpha. Now for angles below about 5 degrees, the cosine of alpha is still close to 1, and since alpha and sine alpha is about 0. So then CL is about CN. In this case, we may also write CL is the area between the lower and upper surface pressure distributions. So now we can derive the lift coefficient from the pressure distribution. But how can we incorporate the effect of compressibility on the lift coefficient? We can do this with the Prandtl-Glauert correction based on the Mach number. Without going into much detail, the effect of compressibility is incorporated using this expression for the pressure coefficient. Cp is Cp0 divided by the square root of 1 minus m squared. Cp0 is the incompressible pressure coefficient. Since it is a correction on the Cp, we can insert this into the equation for the lift coefficient. For a particular Mach number, the correction is a constant, and after some rearranging, we find that the correction also applies to the lift coefficient. So the square root of 1 minus m squared is also called beta. So CL compressible is CL incompressible divided by beta. Since beta is smaller than 1, the lift coefficient increases with growing Mach number. The lift curve slope, or the lift gradient, becomes steeper. It is not the only correction method there is, and it is less accurate for the higher Mach numbers, but it is a simple rule and it's valid for Mach numbers of up to 0.7. The advantage of this correction rule is the fact that it can directly be applied to the lift coefficient. Other, more sophisticated methods need the pressure distribution in terms of CP to correct. To get an idea of the increase of CL with Mach number, for a Mach number of 0.7, a CL of 1 will increase with 40% to 1.4. Next lecture, we will explore the critical Mach number.